After almost a generation, the Iron Curtain remains a reality as well as a symbol of communist tyranny over Eastern Europe. Not only are the movements of once free peoples controlled, but contact with the world of freedom is strictly limited. Books, newspapers, magazines cannot be brought freely into the Soviet-dominated satellites. But an Iron Curtain cannot stop the transmission of radio waves which pass overhead. Munich in West Germany is about 100 miles from the Iron Curtain. In this historic city is located the headquarters of Radio Free Europe. Here in this building, programs are produced that break the communist communications monopoly in five formerly independent countries of Eastern Europe. Programs that oppose communism with the truth. Every day I go to work at Radio Free Europe in Munich. My name is Andrzej Krzeczunowicz. There I am, running up the steps, hurrying to make my first newscast of the day. I show my pass to the guard and stop at the reception desk for the office key. This map shows Radio Free Europe's target countries: Bulgaria, Romania, Hungary, Czechoslovakia and Poland. A total of 80 million people who lost their freedom after World War II. I and my colleagues are exiles from communism. There are almost 500 exiles working for RFE. Editors, actors, announcers, researchers, monitors. My job is newscasting, reading the news in my native language, Polish.
Ważniejsze wiadomości w skrócie. Papież Paweł VI przyjął na audiencji prymasa Polski kardynała Wyszyńskiego. Ministrowie spraw zagranicznych Wielkiej Trójki zdobią dziś rozmowy dotyczące rozbrojenia oraz stosunków między Wschodem i Zachodem.
My colleague, an exile from Czechoslovakia. The news is straight, factual news, without editorial opinions or tactful omissions. News as you might hear it on the radio in America or in any free country. The news in Hungarian.
Gondoskodtak a tájárusításról, de a felmérések szerint további 63 város 1099 iskolájában 680 ezer gyerekről kellene gondoskodni.
New York,
Romanian.
Ministri de externe ai Statelor Unite, Marii Britanii și Uniunii Sovietice își vor continua convorbirile la New York în cursul acestei săptămâni, în speranța de a putea realiza noi acorduri privitoare la dezarmare.
And Bulgarian. Each of us reads material prepared by our own national news desks, written according to the specific interests of listeners in each of our countries.
Че китайски гранични войници са открили огън срещу бегалци, търсещи убежище на съветска територия.
About 100,000 words of news come out of RFE's central newsroom every 24 hours. Reports are received by wire from Western agencies and from RFE's own bureaus in Europe and the United States. Material reaches our national news desks in English, and selections are translated for fresh 10-minute newscasts every hour. This news may include information from behind the Iron Curtain itself. A few miles outside of Munich, RFE's monitoring station picks up the sound of some 40 communist radio stations and 10 communist government news services. With these powerful receivers, we can listen to local communist programs broadcast from hundreds of miles away. That is how we always know just what the communists are telling the people, and just as important, what they are not telling the people in countries where all news is controlled by the Communist Party. This man, another Polish exile, is an RFE monitor, listening from Munich to a program over Radio Warsaw. When reception is bad, the monitor phones engineering and asks them to try another wavelength.
Hallo, Schleißheim. Bitte bessern Sie uns Warschau 1 aus.
Ja, okay.
The communist broadcast is first tape recorded, then typed up by the monitor in the original language, in this case, Polish. Some of the material is dull. some is false and slanderous. All of it is useful. When the communists announce important news, it is picked up at once by an editor.
I am supervising the operation of the monitoring section. Our main task is to keep under full control all home service broadcasts of the five communist European countries to which we broadcast. So we know what they are telling to the people behind the curtain, and of course that they don't want to tell them. And this is our daily production.
The Berlin Wall of Shame. Our Berlin bureau chief describes his impressions of the Brandenburg Gate for listeners the day before President Kennedy visited the city.
On a platform at the Brandenburger Gate, looking over Ulbricht's hideous gray wall.
I take pride in the words, Ich bin ein Berliner.
RFE's bureau in Paris is located on the Champs-Élysées, number 33. Two members of the staff are leaving for news assignments, the young lady for NATO headquarters, and the Romanian reporter for the Quai d'Orsay, location of the French Foreign Office, where he is getting a story on French cultural contacts with Romania, a story that will be sent to Munich by teletype. Not all the news is so far away. Right in Munich itself, RFE's agricultural expert visits an exhibit of farm machinery to help prepare a program for East European farmers.
Principally, that the significance that communist agriculture has been unable to feed populations since the introduction of collectivization.
RFE covers sports. At Innsbruck, a reporter for the Bulgarian department records for broadcast a description of the new Olympic ski jump, from which some of his more daring countrymen will soar a few months hence in the Winter Olympics.
Това е прочутата ски шанса, която побира 60,000 зрители и на която състезатели.
Modern painting has been denounced by Khrushchev, so an RFE Polish reporter records new trends in art.
Наш млади родак, którego Państwo zresztą osobiście przedstawimy za chwileczkę, i poprosimy, żeby powiedział kilka słów na temat swojej twórczości.
Our audiences learn of the latest medical advances in the West. Here, a German doctor is describing a 13-hour operation for replacing hardened arteries with artificial ones. A refugee is interviewed.
Why and how you escaped from Czechoslovakia?
I left Czechoslovakia because the conditions there are very bad for me. And I escaped across the Baltic Sea to West Germany.
From East Germany to West Germany?
From Warnemünde to West Germany.
How long did it take?
I spent 3 days and three nights on the sea.
How did you get there? In this small rubber boat?
Yes, in this small boat. I
in this boat you spent yes, 3 days yes, and three nights on the sea? Boat. Oh, that's a terrific achievement. And now, to end our interview, I would like to ask you to turn to the camera, if you could.
I prefer not, because I left behind the relatives of me.
Well, we can very well understand that. Thank you very much.
To turn this variety of material into radio programs requires the extensive facilities of our Munich headquarters. Our building was constructed in 1951, a year after RFE began brief broadcasts to East Europe. It is open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And it takes some 60 studio technicians to put our programs on the air. We broadcast 18 hours a day to Poland, Czechoslovakia and Hungary, and 5 hours a day to Romania and Bulgaria. Most programs are tape recorded so that they can be broadcast over several transmitters at the same time or repeated later. This is one way to overcome communist jamming. There are about 100 tape recorders in the building. Some 28,000 tapes are stored here. They include important political statements by Western and Eastern leaders, sound effects, and other recordings indispensable to our radio station. Approximately 15% of RFE's airtime is devoted to music. We have 140,000 records, national anthems, folk songs, symphonies, cool jazz, everything from Hungarian czardas to Polish polkas to St. Louis blues. Our library has one of the finest collections of East European books in the West, 18,000 volumes. It's almost like being back in the library in my native city of Lviv. No place this side of the Iron Curtain has more information about East Europe on file. Every fact RFE broadcasts is double-checked for accuracy, so that the communists can never say we made a mistake. RFE regularly receives 700 publications from communist countries. Hundreds of thousands of names of East European government leaders, apparatchiks, diplomats, military figures, policemen, teachers, actors, athletes are in the card files. To make room for more information, they've started to put some records on microfilm. And lots of information is put on paper every day for all of us to read. Spare parts for our broadcasting equipment. Our Munich headquarters are linked by teletype with 9 RFE bureaus in Europe. An open line carries dozens of cables daily between Munich and RFE's New York office. RFE is a partnership of Americans and exiles. Every morning, a policy board of American experts in communist affairs meets with the exile staffs. Here it is agreed what program emphasis will best serve RFE's purpose as a voice of freedom.
Dr. Milev, Bulgaria is among the countries that is asking to buy American wheat. What's your reaction to that?
The Bulgarian regime asked for wheat not only from the United States, but also from Canada. And this demarche could be explained by the very poor harvest this year in Bulgaria. The regime tries to explain it and to justify it with the bad weather, especially the drought. However, the main cause for this bad results in the agriculture is the system of collectivized, the system of collectivization, and also the mismanagement of the collective funds.
I think we all agree that the visit of the Hungarian Prime Minister Kadar to Prague has real political significance for future developments in that country. I think the...
A wide variety of programs is produced by each national department to satisfy the interests and tastes of our distinctly different audiences. RFE has programs on politics, religion, homemaking. We broadcast to music lovers, workers, and intellectuals, among others. Here, the Hungarian department reads greetings from Hungarians in the West to relatives behind the Iron Curtain.
Jugoszláviába, Pulába üzen nagymama. Szeretettel csókollak benneteket a messze távolból, Pulából nagymama.
RFE helped make jazz famous behind the Iron Curtain against communist wishes.
A német Alice és ellen Kessler énekelt. A gitáros amerikai fiú Dwayne Eddy következik, Lonely Boy, Lonely Gitár, magányos fiú, magányos gitár.
A women's program, how to save time in the kitchen, Hungarian style. The young staff member on the right used to listen to RFE at home before she escaped from Hungary. Staff priests discussed the ecumenical
council from our countries, Czechoslovakia, Hungary and Poland, and second, how will work the second session, Father Heidler from Czechoslovakia. Ilu biskupů od vás přijede?
Od nás přijede do Říma skupina 4 biskupů z 15.
Magyarországról viszont 5 püspök, egy apostoli adminisztrátor és 10 tagú küldöttség.
The pianist is playing his own original RFE composition based on a Polish folk song. Listeners in Warsaw have tape recorded it and made it their own. Salvador de Madariaga, the famous Spanish exile, is one of many writers who have recorded talks for intellectuals and scholars in RFE's audience.
I felt confident that I should be able to contribute to the usefulness and to the success of radio university programs. I am convinced that Europe will never materialize unless all the nations of our little continent are free to unite in a federation. For me, therefore, the freedom of Eastern Europe is an essential condition for the healthy life of the European community. Europe is Europe, the whole of it, including Russia. It is imperative that the European Federation should include the countries of Eastern Europe.
A few miles outside of Munich is one of RFE's three transmitting stations. Altogether, there are 31 transmitters with a total power of over 2 million watts.
This is Master Control, the heart of the Munich studio complex. From this panel, programs from 17 local studios and from reporters in the field are brought into the master control console. Here the programs are controlled by the operators for level and quality and dispatched through the outgoing switch panel to RFE shortwave and medium wave broadcasting stations in Germany and Portugal.
Our biggest transmitting station is located in Portugal, 50 miles northeast of Lisbon. Programs are radioed here from Munich and retransmitted behind the Iron Curtain in a fraction of a second. There are over 100 towers in this field of directional antennas that aim our programs at the target, as far as 2,500 miles away. The electric power required here would light 20,000 homes. A replica of RFE's symbol, the Freedom Bell. That sound is a communist jammer at work, and this machine is recording the effect of jamming on RFE. The communists spend over $100 million a year jamming broadcasts from the West. Technicians listen to RFE signals and report daily on their strength and clarity. Jamming does interfere with some broadcasts, but over 90% of our programs get through to listeners. Every year, hundreds of Americans who contribute voluntarily to the support of RFE visit our headquarters. RFE is a private organization which raises money through the annual Radio Free Europe Fund drives in the United States. These visitors from the United States are about to be briefed by the Public Relations Director.
So far as jamming is concerned, Radio Free Europe certainly is jammed. In fact, the communists spend well over $100 million a year for the purpose of jamming out Western broadcasts. But Radio Free Europe can combat this massive interference in several ways. A given program can go on as many as 5 to 7 wavelengths at the same time. Also, we can repeat programs several times during the day. In addition to this, our transmitter location in Portugal gives us a great advantage over the communist jammers. Our signal goes up against the ionosphere, 200 or 300 miles high, bounces down into the target area. This gives us a great advantage over the communist jammers, which are much farther to the east. Now, how well does the Radio Free Europe broadcast get through the communist jamming? If you look for a moment at the charts prepared by the Audience Research Department, they will tell you a great deal about the listening possibilities and the listening habits of the people to whom we broadcast behind the Iron Curtain.
Could you tell us, sir, do you ever receive any indication that the important figures in the governments of these countries react to your transmissions?
Rather than try to explain that to you in so many words, I'd much prefer to show you a short film that we've made on that very subject. Would you begin the film, please?
One of the highest compliments that can be paid RFE is an attack by the communists themselves. In Warsaw, First Party Secretary Gomulka said, "Falsehoods flow into our country over the air from capitalist broadcasting stations such as Radio Free Europe. Polish communists attacked RFE because it nullifies censorship." When Vice President Nixon visited Warsaw, the communist press said nothing about the time of his arrival. RFE announced the time Mr. Nixon's plane would land. This was the result.
It's interesting to remember that Radio Free Europe began as...
Our visitors frequently ask us, how does RFE determine the size of its audience? How do we know which of our programs are most popular in East Europe? Interviews are conducted under RFE supervision with thousands of visitors to the West and with refugees. Our audience research director explains how this work is carried on.
To estimate the size of our audiences, we use the most modern polling techniques adapted to our special situation. Since we cannot get behind the Iron Curtain, we interview travelers, tourists, and refugees in such cities as Vienna, Stockholm, Paris, and Rome.
Since we cannot take a representative sample, we take as many different samplings as possible. One of these may be composed of traveling workers, another one businessmen or students. Now, using a rather complex mathematical and statistical evaluation process, we combine all these samples into one more or less representative sample. So far as the mechanical processing of the data are concerned, they are coded and then punched on IBM cards.
East Europe is changing. Moscow's grip isn't as tight as it once was. Cautious contacts to the West are opening up. RFE must keep up with the times. This is the Romanian Broadcasting Department discussing new ideas for programs that will attract young listeners.
Hello, yes, Gordon? All right, at 2 o'clock. Fine, I'll be there at 2 o'clock in your office. Thank you, bye.
The director will exchange ideas with American program experts.
Hi,
Freda. Hi, Gordon.
The director of RFE's Romanian Broadcasting Department has an opportunity to discuss new program plans with American radio executives. At such informal meetings, program schedules are worked out on an individual basis for each of our target countries. Romanians, for example, are especially interested in what is going on in Italy, Spain, and Latin America because of Romania's historic development as an essentially Latin country. American radio programming techniques have been adapted to make RFE lively and interesting. Particular emphasis is given to programs that will appeal to young people who are bored by repetitious communist propaganda. And even our cafeteria, with East Europeans, West Europeans, and Americans eating together, is a tiny symbol of a future when no Iron Curtain shall divide the world. Rodney Smith, RFE's director, is a forward-looking man.
Thank you. Gentlemen, good news. The board of directors has approved the purchase of the four new transmitters we've been pressing for.
Good. That'll just about double our transmitter power.
And this fits right into the subject of our meeting today. Getting these new transmitters, coupled with the increased ferment in Europe, makes our recruiting project for young exile talent more urgent than ever before. How's this coming along?
We've got a good start, sir, but it's going to take time. We've been as far afield as Australia looking for talented young editors.
We should keep right on this. I wish you'd ask each of the broadcasting departments to submit regular recurring reports. Will you take care of this?
Yes, sir.
Work in Portugal goes forward on new equipment to increase RFE's signal strength. And our broadcasts continue day after day. I have been working for RFE for 10 years and have no other plans for the future. One reason I want to help carry on this work is contained in a recent letter that reached us from a young girl, in which she says, "Dear friends, thanks for the voice of freedom. I have listened to you since the beginning of your broadcasts. Today I am 22, and for most of what I know about the world, I have to thank Radio Free Europe. My only window to the world are your broadcasts."
Remember, the Iron Curtain isn't soundproof. Radio Free Europe gets the truth through. Please send your contribution to Radio Free Europe Fund, Box 1964, Mount Vernon, New York. Thank you.